Ah, thank you for this wonderful introduction. So, recap. Okay, so this was a category of stable maps. So it comes with a grading. It's the number of floors minus one, so European notation for the top floor. Then there are stable maps have outgoing, ingoing ends. So we have two kind of evaluation maps, which are functors. Then having this structure here, we can build a weak fibered product. Then there are this sort of chopping functors. If you take a building with top floor I plus j plus 1, then you can chop it at a particular place indicated by these two numbers, and you get two buildings connected by a morphism in P. Then trivial cylinder buildings, let me point out, are never objects by themselves because they don't satisfy the stability condition. But if you have a stable object, you can add one to them or more. And then one can take disjoint union of two objects, and which produces sort of a finite dimensional family of objects because you can sort of shift them against each other. So then, is what I call the more sophisticated Facebook functor. So in order to distinguish subcategories, so the subcategory associated to this would be just all objects where this is positive, but each object would have a weight. In the particular case where it's 0 and 1, then 0 you wouldn't take this object, and 1 you would. So then we had that in this category, we can talk about pseudo-holomorphic object, and that was sort of the functor which takes value 0 if it's not pseudo-holomorphic and 1 if it is. And it had this property, and when we want to perturb this here into some other functor sort of close by, but of course we don't know yet what that means, which is then, and the associated subcategory will be sort of the thing we are going to work with, but it should also have additional structures which we will introduce during these lectures. So that was one of the properties which we wanted perturbations to have, and this is satisfied in particular for this one. Okay, so this was so far algebraic, there was nothing, no topology, nothing. So whatever object I introduce will survive the whole lecture, but it will, during the lecture, having more and more properties because of additional structures one can put on the objects. And the structures actually turn out to be more or less natural things. So what you see here are more or less natural constructions after you fix some discrete set of data. Then it turns out, then of course, the invariance might depend on it, but if you take a different set of data, there's actually comorbidism between one choice and the other. And it's independent of these choices as well. So, I don't know what a good, how I should call this thing. So, GCT is easy to say. GC, groupoidal category, and T stands for topology. So it consists out of a groupoidal category. So the stable maps was an example of this. So by definition, this means that between any two objects, you have finitely many morphisms, at most finitely many morphisms. Each morphism is an isomorphism, and in addition to this, I require that this, we have only isomorphisms, and I require that the isomorphism classes, so if I identify isomorphic objects, so that could a priori be a class, is actually a set. Yeah, and on this set, I want to have a metrizable topology. So if you look at the stable map, so look for example at in Gromov-Witten. At the modelized space. Yeah? You could make a completely similar setup like this. Actually, if I replace R cross V by a symplectic manifold, just allow nodes, I get a category of stable maps for Gromov-Witten. Then you have the pseudo-holomorphic objects. And if then you take the equivalence class of pseudo-holomorphic objects, then that is a Gromov space. Now it has a topology, and in fact it comes from a topology defined also on other objects which are not pseudo-holomorphic. So you can imagine how that looks like with stable maps. So I didn't say which quality I take, but I take a quality of a function for which I can do analysis. So that would be H3 away from the H3 locks, and Sobolev space H3 away from the punctures. And at the punctures, if you introduce the nodes, introduce polar coordinates you want, that in this polar coordinates it's H3 with weights. So that's the quality, then you can do analysis. Yeah? The weights have to be adjusted to spectral gaps associated to the periodic orbits. Okay. So then you can imagine what the topology is away from the nodes. So you have a sequence of such things. You go to isomorphism classes. Then you can replace in this isomorphism classes. So something should be the limit. Then you can use a limit thing by plumbing at the nodes and so on, and away from this it would converge in H3, and you have to say something, as already pointed out last week, complicated near the nodes. Yeah.
So why three?
Well, so suppose I would have take 1 billion 1, then you would ask me, why do you take 1 billion 1? Okay, so I can take everything greater or equal to three. So first of all, I want to work in a Hilbert space and have partitions of unity and so on. And then I need an embedding to C1. On two domains to C1, because when you construct sort of the smooth structure, you have to actually to divide out by group and have to take some transversal constraints. So H3 is sort of the smallest Hilbert space I can take. But it doesn't really matter.
It works in
anything. Sorry for the joke. So anyway, so now, first theorem. So after we made our choices, one can show that there's a natural metrizable topology. Yeah. So there's no, I mean, you don't have any choices. That is, give you a recipe how to construct the basis of the topology. Of course, different person might construct a different basis, but the associated topology is the same. So it's natural. So always when you do mathematics and you don't base, I mean, and everything is natural, it usually looks to me like you're going in a good direction. Yeah? So that's natural.
I didn't understand here. The orbit space of what?
Stable maps. The orbit space of stable maps. So when I define the stable maps, I have to say what quality of variables, functions I take.
Yeah? What is the word orbit space?
Isomorphism classes, which is a set. So, and in fact, if you would know what that means, what the topology is, then if you look at the subset generated by pseudo-holomorphic objects, the induced topology is precisely which we defined for SFT with several authors. Okay. And if you replace this category by stable maps in the Gromov-Witten context, then it would be sort of the Concewitz version, which is Hausdorff, so that would be precisely the topology induced by the natural topology which you have there.
How important for your theory is it that you have finite stabilizers?
Not really, but it makes things. So, actually, when we started this project, we had a lot of energy. So we wrote a lot of pages about that we could have Lie groups, compact Lie groups, as stabilizers. So that definitely, you can generalize this theory to this. And then during the course of the thing, I thought I might even have infinite dimensional groups. So SC smooth groups, but I don't know, for this I don't know a good application yet. But the language is extremely flexible. But with compact Lie groups, you could see if you have sort of other group actions on the space and so on, this kind of stuff might arise. Okay, so this we already introduced last week. So assume this is a 10M polyfold. So this is sort of the next thing to a manifold with boundary and corners, or Banach manifold with boundary corners. Suppose we have a finite group, a group homomorphism, so that we have an action by diffeomorphisms, and then the associated translation groupoid is a category where the objects are actually this points here, And vesomorphisms are all those pairs where G is a group element and Q a point, and they are being viewed as morphisms from Q to G star Q. So this is also a category. Yeah? So if you have group action, you get a category where the morphisms are basically the group elements together with the information of the starting point, and the end point is G star, is the point obtained under the action.
So, Hamid, are you saying you think you could replace G by a new group?
Well, what would be the theory here if you have a Lie group? So in this category, so you usually would look at what are interesting functors? They're functors. You go into this group, and then from this thing, you could go by morphism somewhere. So, but let's not go into this. Let's discuss. Yeah, so maybe I'm already running out of time here. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Is it just a repackaging of the idea of the group action?
Yeah. Just view it as a category. I want to bring it on a footing that I can compare it now with my category. So, a uniformizer now. So this is now an abstract category with a similar properties like stable maps. Yeah. So groupoidal with a metrizable topology on the orbit space on the class of on the set of isomorphism classes. And so a uniformizer with isotropy at the object alpha with isotropy G, yeah, so alpha is a functor from this groupoid, from this category, yeah, from such a category of that which looks like this, which has the following. So it's injective on objects and fully faceful. Yeah, so that means injective on objects clear. Fully faceful means that if you have two objects, then the morphisms there go to the morphism set of their image points bijectively. Then if you assume that there's a point which is actually mapped to this object, you assume that the image of objects, and you go to isomorphism classes, is open in C, and you require that if you pass to isomorphism classes, you get a homeomorphism onto that open set. So you have seen such things. If you are given an orbifold, then the neighborhood of a point in orbifold you parametrize like this here as well. Yeah. So, but here we just have this requirements that would be. So here's sort of the picture. So we have this enormous category here, which is not a set, but assume sort of that most isomorphisms go like this. It's something like if you look at the orbit by isomorphisms, view this as a group action. Now you want to take a sort of a transversal slice to this, to the isomorphisms, but you can't obviously in general because of isotropy. Yeah? So you try to be as good as possible, transversal, taking into account as isotropy. Then here is the orbit space, which is a topological space. You have this thin thing here, which is the isomorphism classes associated to this thing here. And you map this here into this category. And sort of the isomorphisms go sort of in this direction. Yeah? So that this thing here would sort of, let's say, collapse everything if I go to isomorphism classes to that thing. Yeah? So it's something, so we have to talk about compatibility of this object, but it's something like this. So if you have a lot of isomorphisms in this direction, so the differential geometry of this category is something like this. So I put a uniformizer in and look at the trace of a functor. Now I have a smooth structure on this. Yeah? If I see manifolds, if I have a subcategory and it hits my hand in manifolds, that's already some structure. If I put this hand in, I see also manifolds, and if there's a morphism from here to here, I have a local change of coordinates which explains what I see in this picture on that picture. Is that?
I have no idea what you said.
Okay, good. So, thank you. thank you. Okay, so I just want to say what will be the idea of a smooth structure on this category. So I want ultimately like study a functor on this, like our Facebook functor. Yeah? What should be a smooth Facebook functor? Yeah? So suppose it's the original one, 0 or 1. So it likes some objects, it doesn't like some other objects. So let's assume here in this room, the isomorphisms go mostly in this direction, and I put a uniformizer in it like this. So now I look at the trace of the liked objects on my hand. And suppose they line up as a manifold, so I see pieces of manifold. And if I put my hand in here, I see pieces of manifold. So let's assume they went through one object here, alpha and alpha prime, which are sort of related by an isomorphism. Then what you want to have is of a change of coordinates from here to here, which explains what I see in this picture to that picture. Yeah? And you can formalize a lot of things, like you can give conditions on this functor that what you see here is actually is a topological subspace, they're compact, and from the smooth structure here will inherit a smooth structure and will be a manifold. So you can actually formalize everything on the language of functors, which is rather easy. And then there's some abstract theory which tells you that there are a lot of interesting objects you can create from this. Yeah, so that actually in the approach here, you work on a level where sort of the language is easy, and there's a certain amount of additional infrastructure somewhere which tells you you can basically construct whatever you want out of this by just basic, I mean, it's abstract business. Yeah? So rather than proving things about modelized spaces where at each point you have to work very hard because you're on the wrong level. So, okay, so this is what I'm explaining now. This was just the preview.
In terms of what you said on the last slide, right now we only have topological charts and we have not yet.
Yes, I have not explained yet. Of course, I could say if I have a subcategory here and I look at the trace of this, I could say it looks smooth now with respect to that chart. Because you know, I see the objects in O and so on. But of course, I have to compare them on different things. So that's the next. So suppose I have two such uniformizers. Then I build the weak fibered product, which is the following. You go from O, you go into this category, get this, and you go with the other into this category. And if you look at an image point here, you assume they are connected. You look at only those pairs of points which are connected by an isomorphism. Yeah, so z phi z prime, so that the image under psi is connected to the image under psi prime of the point z.
Why do you call this b prime phi?
Because of this here.
It's a static
fibered
product.
Yeah, it's the usual
fibered product. Yeah, but there are the, if you're a topologist, it's, yeah. If you're used to
the product,
it's a usual fibered product, but if you're as a topologist.
I mean, sometimes real fiber products also occur. So weak fiber product between categories. Okay, so I'm coming from a different planet, so what can I say? Okay, so this here we call the transition set. Yeah? And now, of course, what we would have to know of this is a smooth structure on this. So here, let me point out to you what the structural things are. So if you have this, you can go to, if you look at this data, you can take the projection to z, you can take the projection to z prime. So projection onto the first thing we call source map. So these are all rather standard things if you do Lie group holds or so. Target map. Then there is a map which associates to an object here, just this tuplet here, where this is the one map. The one isomorphism, yeah, at the image pair of Q. You have an inversion map, yeah, just interchange the role here and just replace this by the inverse. Then you build here, this is the real fibered product without morphisms in between, the source and the target. So you require that the target of that one is the source of this one, so you can actually compose this, which means this actually can be composed. Multiplication map. And this, so this is, I mean, it's nothing deep, it's just the only thing, the only interesting things you can do. And the maps above are called structure maps. Okay, so now, here is what a polyfold structure for this is. So it's a construct, so in real terms the following. So with all these kind of categories which appear in real life, the objects in this category are usually are geometric objects and they have enough geometry to build something. Like if you do Dillon-Mumford theory, you could look at the category of stable Riemannian surfaces. And you just take one object, and then by gluing, by cutting and pasting, gluing, you can actually construct a neighborhood in the isomorphism classes. So the point is that these categories, which occur in symplectic geometry, for example, but others, the objects are not just only points, but they are geometric objects. And then you can actually give, in general, a recipe. You just say, take an object, do this, do that, blah, blah, blah. There might be several choices involved. But at the end of the day, for each object, there's a set of constructions you can do. So here, a polyfold structure. So there would be a functor from C into set, category of sets, which associates to an object a set of such uniformizers. Yeah, so for each object, there's a construction, I get a set of such uniformizers. Then if you have an isomorphism between two such objects, you get a bijection between the construction here and the construction there. So in general, you can say a lot about it. So it's sort of an equivalence of constructions. If you know one object and do the other, then usually the data which you choose here by this morphism corresponds to a precise set of data on this slide. So this, in general, in application, like stable maps and everything, this bijection can be very precisely explained. And then there's a construction which associates to two such uniformizers a tame M-polyfold structure on this transition set so that these things are true. Yeah? Like the source and target map are local diffeomorphisms. The unit map is smooth. The inversion map is an SC diffeomorphism. And multiplication is smooth. So think of this as a maximal recipe atlas for this category. So for Gromov-Witten, for SFT, and for others, there's a set of rules. You write it down, maybe as a page, what you have to do. Take an object, do this and this and this, and then you get F. And then usually this comes out implicit from the construction. So the hard part is actually in this concrete cases to define the F and come up with the right set of conditions. So now, if you have this, so let's me.
I'm sorry, I'm confused.
Yeah.
Why is IOTA a scale diffeomorphism, not a local scale diffeomorphism?
Because there's an inverse I.
Oh, sorry, I was
IOTA.
Mixed up with another of the letters.
So this is just the inversion. So. So when I have one slice here and one slice here, and I have a morphism going, and this point here is psi of z, and this is psi prime of z prime, and this is phi. Then that's one of the important conditions here. So then S would map this to z. So this here is a point here, and this would be mapped to Z prime. And then what does that mean? S and T are local SC diffeomorphisms. That just means if you start moving this point here, the source would move, and this endpoint would move smoothly. So if you have a slice here, and my functor would cut out a manifold here, and I have here in the isomorphic, then actually I could near this object take this isomorphism, and it would actually isomorphically, diffeomorphically identify it with that manifold here, for example. Huh? So it's actually pretty amazing just having this definition what you can do. You can write a whole book about it. It's like, when you introduce the notion of a manifold, yeah, we know you can write books about it. So if you start here, you can do as well. And why can you write books about it? Because there are a lot of constructions you can do on that level without going to local coordinates. Of course, when you do the proofs, you have to. You have to go back to basics for certain things. But you can do a lot of constructions. And of course, I think you're always happy when you study a concrete problem, where usually this is the moment where you have to get your hands dirty, and then you creep up, you go up, and you come to some level where you can apply some theory, which means there's a lot of implicit construction or given constructions you can apply, and then usually things progress quite fast. Yeah? So, and it's principally here as well. So, okay. So this is the basic notion. So let's see what we can do with this. So let me first say, for example, which maybe comes up later, but not now, if you have such a smooth structure defined, so that's the notion of a smooth structure here. Actually, if your category, so, so if you have such a structure, then there's a tangent construction, for example. You can associate to such a category a tangent. You can associate, then you can take witness sums of this tangent. You can look at particular functors which resemble to be differential forms. So what so you take a direct sum of these things. Then it turns out to such a psi, then there's a T psi. Yeah, if it goes from the tangent space of O into the tangent category. And then, of course, you can pull back such a functor, and when it looks in local coordinates smooth, it's a smooth thing. But you don't have to check it for each object, you just have to check it for an isomorphism class of an object, for the functoriality, if it's thing is smooth. So you see already, so you can do a certain number of things. So it turns out that in the case of stable maps, you have the evaluation functors at marked points. If you pull back a differential form, it will actually be a differential form on the tangent, on C. So it's all compatible with the usual stuff. So here are certain things which are immediate also and important. There is a degeneracy functor. So if you have this smooth structure on this category, this polyfold structure, there's a degeneracy functor. Namely, it just defines the degeneracy of the object alpha to be that of an object representing it. That's independent because the degeneracy is being preserved by the transition maps. Yeah, so if I take two representatives, then I have this thing here and it preserves the D. So it's well defined. And then the objects have level structures. You can say, for example, alpha has regularity K, if you can write it like this, and that lies actually in OK on the level K. Yeah, so it inherits everything you saw from M polyfold. Okay, now let's talk about the smooth versions of subcategories. So here is a nice looking polyfold, your square. So let's first say what we can say about submanifolds in this case, but the picture is the same in general. So general position would be something like this. If it's say one dimension, it shouldn't hit in the corner. Yeah? So general position and transversally at the boundary. Good position, well, that still is okay here to come out like this, but of course it's not general position because this is one dimension, should hit not a corner. But you might have stupid things like this, but they might still be retracts. So these are possibilities for submanifolds. So now the general definition now is the following. So if O is an M polyfold and M is subset, then we have heard what a subpolyfold is of this. This is a subset which is locally a retract. But now I require more. I require a retract such that if I lift the index by one here, that this is SC smooth. What does that mean? This means the differentiability property is stronger. Now, if you go from U to U, we have SC smoothness. If I go one up, if I shift the index by one and require differentiability, I'm actually dividing by a smaller norm, so differentiability is a stronger condition. And it turns out that if you have a set which locally is a retract of something which has this property, then, first of all, it's called a submanifold, and for good reason, namely, the induced structure from the M polyfold on it is a subpolyfold structure, which, however, has an equivalent set of charts, which are actually usual manifold charts.
So you mean finite
dimensional? Yeah, yes, so why is it finite dimensional? So first of all, if R goes from U into U1, U1 goes to U2, goes into U3, and so on, and R composed with R is R. So the image lies in U infinity. So such retracts can only retract onto smooth points. So then, when you are at a smooth point, so you need just level one, then you can take the tangent map of R, and at each smooth point you have a tangent space. So the tangent of R on that tangent space is, of course, the identity. So TR on a point in this thing is the identity. But because of this one in compact inclusion, the identity is compact. The identity is compact, it has to be finite dimensional. Yeah? So if you have this here, you see that on the tangent space, the identity is compact. So then it's actually a good exercise like this. So then you take the tangent space, and actually nearby you can represent by an implicit function theorem the solution space as a graph over the tangent space in local corners. Okay. So this we already know. A weighted subcategory was this functor into 0, 1, which associates to an object a rational number in this range. Then the support, so the support are the objects we want, but they have a function, the restricted function, which is a weight. So now what is a smooth version of this? A smooth weighted locally finite dimensional subcategory is a weighted subcategory so that the following holds. So if I take an isomorphism class in C, I pick an alpha in that isomorphism class and take such a uniformizer, which map that point Q0 to alpha, then you can find an open neighborhood around this and properly embedded finite dimensional submanifolds here, so that this functor is written in this way. So it's an indication. So if this is positive, it means it lies on a smooth submanifold, and the number of occurrences where that is, each of those manifolds calls 1 over the number of elements in your family, and this just counts on how many manifolds you lie, divided by the number of manifolds you have. Yeah? So for example, if theta takes the value 0 or 1, you would just see one manifold here, and it would just be 1 if you lie on the manifold, and otherwise you wouldn't. Yeah, so trivial. Are you guys with me?
This is like being a constructible function?
Don't ask me this, I don't know. Why should I? In general, no. So, then of course you can have different flavors like locally equidimensional, they have all the same dimension, in general position to the boundary, in good position to the boundary. This thing could be tame, orientable, oriented, and so on. So you have all these different flavors for these things. So here I give you some exercises, how you can consolidate this thing with what you know. So then if this is oriented, and we have a differential form, which I haven't introduced, you can actually integrate this over that. And how do you do this? Well, there is an interpretation of the stuff above by data on the orbit space. And the differential form defines you a signed measure on the orbit space, and you have the weight on the orbit space, and you just integrate the weight with respect to the signed measure. And it turns out you have Stokes' theorem and this kind of stuff.
Can you explain how it could be that you have this description of theta locally, but you can't globalize it to the whole category?
Well, you have these bits and pieces lying all over. I mean, so let me give you an example, then you see how that would work. So let me first give the picture. So in local coordinates, you see all these MIs flying around here. This is U of, so on O, you have the action of G. Then you have all these manifolds lying here. And that is sort of the local picture you see. If you have a smooth functor like this, that is a picture you see if you stick your hand in. And look on my hand, I see the green stuff.
The green stuff with the MI?
These are the MI, that is what I see. The red stuff is the neighborhood U of Q, and O is the domain of the uniform. So I stick my hand in, that is, I see the green stuff. If I stick my hand in here, I see some other green stuff, and if there's something isomorphic, then this S, the fact that this in the structure S and T are local diffeomorphism, it maps a point here diffeomorphically to the picture which I would see. In this picture, however, you might, for example, it could be, so if I have a certain number of manifolds doing this, I could, for example, take another copy of each manifold and just decrease the weight by one, by half. That would also be a representation here, so you can change this. So here are some exercises and remarks. So assume you have a smooth weighted subcategory like this, and assume theta only assumes values 0 and 1 between two objects, and between two objects, the associated subcategory, there is, in the associated subcategory, those where theta is positive, there is at most one morphism between any two objects, and further assume that all objects have degeneracy zero, so in some sense they lie on the interior so that I don't have to talk about boundary, show that the support of this is in a natural way a smooth compact manifold without boundary. So what you have is that the orbit space is compact, you have these local pictures, you have the diffeomorphism between it, and just glue this stuff together, the local pictures. Yeah? So that's a, so now let's
get rid of the boundary in that picture. I mean,
because degeneracy is zero.
Oh, degeneracy is zero. Oh,
so
because your boundary is always
yeah. So degeneracy. So if I wouldn't say this, then what would happen is I get a submanifold in the sense of the definition which I have, which might, however, have horrible boundary things.
Okay. Okay.
But you would have tangent spaces at these manifolds at the boundary, and if they would lie in good position to the boundary, then actually you can show that this would be manifold with boundary in corners, each the MIs. This one.
What is the definition of this good condition again? Lying in a good condition.
Or good condition just basically means that something like that. So the definition in general is a bit more complicated, but that the tangent space doesn't lie like this. It just goes off nicely in, and if you wiggle a little bit, it would still go nicely in.
And that's the minimum condition you want.
This is one of the possible things you can require. I mean, smooth thing just means you have this smooth representation like that. But then you could start requiring all kinds of things of your manifolds, like orientable, all having locally the same dimension, on the boundary lying in good condition to the boundary, lying in general condition to the position to the boundary, and so on. So these guys occur in all kinds of different flares. And here are two of them. So if say everything is has degeneracy zero, and between any two objects there's at most one morphism, and the orbit space is compact, then this thing has a natural smooth manifold structure induced from the polyfold structure on the category. If I then require that, again, I require that you all have only values zero and one, but assume that I don't say anything about how many morphisms I have between two objects, then actual support is a smooth compact orbifold. So with this language, then two possible things happen. So it describes manifolds and orbifolds. And then the most general thing is that you can have rational weights, and it looks a little bit wilder. Yeah, so that's the generalization. So there's one overall more general notion. And if you specialize and require additional properties, they reproduce things which you know. But the whole formalism is actually much closer to the constructions you do if you want to construct a moduli space. So the level on which I talk is sort of streamlined for saying the least amount necessary to construct something. And then everything else, we just say sort of abstract stuff you can do. You know, so and in not so long, there will be actually a book about all this abstract things, construction. For each individual case, presumably you only need a fraction to do. So you can integrate and all kinds of things. So basically, the construction of a modulized space comes up, you have to get a good recipe. If I give you an object, there has to be a good recipe what to do with this object, and there's a local construction on object. And as we see, then we also have to introduce bundles over this, and then we can talk about the Kusch-Riemann functor. And then when I extend the smooth notions to this, we will actually have a perturbation theory for functors, for certain classes of functors. Okay, so this is already said. So there's a tangent construction, and then if this is oriented, you have actually a formula like this, and so on. So this is then what you see if you construct this transversal moduli spaces, and you worked out the orientations, you integrate forms over this. But it also tells you that if you view things from this general perspective, so if you want to do SFT, the only differential forms which ever matter would be pullbacks of forms by the evaluation map at a marked point, and forgetting the map and collapsing unstable structures and go into the Lillien-Mumford space. So this evaluation may actually turn out to be smooth functors. And then if you pull this back, this would be a particular type of this differential forms. But there should be many, many others which perhaps see somewhat the topology of the function spaces itself. Then the data you get doesn't have so much compatibility, so they cannot be represented as SFT, but they might be representable then in some other way.
Do you have some interpretation of what the Perron complex computes?
Yeah, I don't have an interpretation, so what it is. So it just exists. So and I think there are, my feeling is there are many, many forms than we just ever used. And it must have to do something with, so if you fix the Riemann surface and look at all maps into the manifold, and then you divide out by being isomorphic things, so it sees on some level, I think, the functions, sort of the function spaces from Riemann surfaces into the manifold. And there's more topology. Yeah, so but if you use such forms, I think, then it restricts you in what kind of invariance you can get. So if you pull back the other forms, you have a lot of symmetries and so on, which you wouldn't. But who cares? But I think there should be other theories as well.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Can you give an example of a scale smooth weighted locally finite or whatever words are, which where the local description can't be localized?
What does it even really mean?
That they do not exist a finite list of subcategories. Well,
so
how about anything that's a, I mean, that's an immersion, but not embedding finite dimensions. But that at least answers your question previously, right? If I have just a figure eight, I can't write this as a union of.
Yeah. Okay. So something like this. Yeah.
That would be an example of.
That's something which requires this local descriptions, locally finite union of embeddings, but isn't globally a finite union of embeddings.
But that figure eight is a thing which can occur in this thing.
Sure, we can have much worse things.
Oh yeah, figure eight. Yeah, so in the transversality results, during homotopies, bad things can happen. So the thetas you construct are usually not everywhere smooth, but they can have singularities and singularities. Singularity sets which you have to throw away and which you can distinguish and so on. So theory has a natural metrizable topology. We already knew this, turning this, and then has a natural polyfold structure after fixing a mono. It's a minimal amount of discrete data actually, but the construction is so general that it actually you can use the same construction and then fix the minimal amount of data. So ultimately, so whatever comes out of it doesn't depend on.
What is S and what is SP?
SP?
S is the category of stable maps, and S of P is the weak fiber product over this.
So then S of P is a weak fiber product, which you introduced last time to say how theta should behave, and that also has an induced structure then. And then here, the nice thing, so there's sort of a natural construction for a smooth structure. Then the nice thing is, of course, sort of is some kind of reality check. The degeneracy index from the polyfold structure agrees with the grading functor. So when we did the algebra, the grading functor was the height of the building minus one. So now if I have a smooth structure, I have a grading functor coming from that. And they are the same. Yeah, so the structure takes building height into account and preserves this quantity on a geometric level. So now we having this topology, a lot of structure happens. So we have the orbit space. We can talk about the connected components in the orbit space, pi zero. We can talk about connected components there, where this here is just the orbit space of that. Then if I have a connected component, I have an associated category for this, namely all objects which are isomorphic to an element in A, where the isomorphism class lies in A. Then there are faces. Actually, all the combinatorics now comes from this in SFT. So a face, you take a connected component in that topological space in the subspace where D equals 1. So you just take honest boundary points. Yeah? You take buildings of height 2, so top floor is 1, and you take the closure of this. So here's an example in dimension in differential geometry. Yeah. So if I have this here, the square, then I would have to take this point first away. Then this here would be a connected component of D equals 1, honest boundary points. Then I take the closure, then I get that, including these points. Here's another example. Here's another connected component. Takes the closure. I get that point again. So I get 4 faces in this case. And they overlap at those points. And the number of overlaps at a given point is actually the degeneracy index. So then you can think about this here, if you have that. And then you get three phases coming together, the interior points here. Close this up, you get sort of this sector here and in front. Now, so it's a fact that the degeneracy index is precisely the number of phases you live in. If an interior point of is no phase, zero. Honest boundary point, one phase. Simple corner point, you lie in two phases, and so on.
You can have four phases, though, in this picture, potentially, if you had four lines coming.
Yeah, but that wouldn't be allowed in that, yeah, so in that theory, but it would, I don't allow that in my structure here because I have boundary with corners always. But we had a discussion of this last week. You could rather than taking quadrants, partial quadrants, you could, I think you could replace it by convex sets with non-empty interior. So then you could generalize it somewhat. So in particular, you could have polygonal boundaries and so on.
Hamoud, sorry, what do you mean with right arrow S sub A?
Right arrow, red stuff. There's not S sub A. Given a connected component, there's an associated subcategory. Namely, all objects whose isomorphism class belongs to A.
Also given a phase, there's an associated...
Yes, then given a phase, there's an associated category. So if the phase lies in A, it's a subcategory of SA. So if this here is A, then this could be an S theta, which is of a subcategory of that thing, which would be the closed thing here.
And this awful Z sub P.
Yes.
Can you maybe say how is the realization of S sub P connected to the realization of S?
Well, it's so each so locally, because it sort of goes in this discrete category, it is a product of things in S. Yeah, once you fix your arrow.
So Z sub P is something like a fiber product of Z?
Yeah, so C sub P is a union of fiber products starting with at least two factors.
And
this has a this also has, you know, you just forgot the market, I mean, it has a topology as well.
So let's say I have a building of height 5 and Z.
Yeah.
It sort of happens, I don't know, 25 times in Z sub P.
Yes, because you could shop actually 5 times, or you could shop at different places.
Just shopping once, or can I shop several times?
Well, you can shop several times, and it lies in a longer product. So I could take a building of length 25, and I'd chop it into 5 buildings of length 5, of height 5.
Right.
Or 4, actually. Yeah. So, that is where all the compatibility comes from, that if you see a stable thing, you could shop it in different ways, which lie in some sense below and were perturbed. But when you take the different combinations back, it should be the same perturbation on the next level. Yeah?
So I don't understand the second to last line, because if I take like a teardrop in R2 with the right angle at the origin, then that right angle, then the origin is degeneracy 2, but it's only in one phase.
Are you demanding phase structure?
What is a phase structure?
Are you demanding phase structure? Because that's...
Oh, here... So not at this point. So here what could happen is, I think that is what you want to say. If I have something like this,
yeah.
then that would be the phase here.
Right, so the origins...
So at this point. But what will turn out, locally, what I said before, the degeneracy index is the number of phases you lie in, is only true with local phases. Yeah. So here is actually one phase, but if locally there are actually two. Yeah. So thanks.
So your S sub theta there then does not really have the structure of.
So then it turns out that picture actually never arises in for stable maps.
Right.
No, that, yeah.
And also, so your S sub A there, does that contain broken buildings or?
Oh yeah. So it contains. So if you take any unbroken building, you take sort of all the limits you can take.
Okay. So it's not just the interior, you mean?
No. So that is actually where the whole structure comes from. That an SA has boundaries connected, which consists out of broken things, and an SB has also this, but they have sort of common things also. That is what intertwines the whole thing.
Like if I have a disk with two merge points on the boundary, and this one can collide into this one from this side, or it can go around and collide into it from that side. That sounds like it's that picture.
Yeah.
So you said that picture is nothing.
No, so it does not happen for stable maps. I mean, in this case, in the relative case, I don't know, but here in this case.
You have no boundary functions.
Well, there's no boundary. So, now in our particular case, actually the faces containing a point actually are ordered, and you can see it like this. If this is a building, and this are the periodic orbits, the interface periodic orbits. So this stands for the top periodic, for the collection of top periodic orbits, bottom periodic orbits, first interface, second interface, third interface. So then this here, things which contain this is a face. Yeah, and the closure of this. So if you have this stuff degenerate, it might degenerate into something like this. Then if you break a little bit higher, the same, and you break here, the same. Yeah, because in our theory, there's more energy associated to this, or less. There's different complexity if I go up. If I have to, so I measure if I have branched cylinders and so on. There's some complexity, also some energy associated with this. So here, these are the closures of these things are the faces. They all contain this thing here, and I order them in such a way that if I break at the lowest thing, it's the first face. If I break higher, it's the second, and so on. So if I take the closure of this, it's smaller than that phase, it's smaller than that phase.
So they're all of the same energy?
No, they're all in the same space where that lies. I mean, they're different spaces, but they intersect all in that space. But a phase, in our case, is you just give outgoing, ingoing, and where it should break. This set of periodic orbits prescribed, that's a phase.
Right, so you said something about energy being different.
Yes. This breaks higher, so it has this thing has more energy here.
The lowest piece
has more energy.
I see.
But those are all codimensional one faces.
They all have codimensional one. Yeah, so you have an ordering on this stuff. Okay, so start now with a face, and then look at the map F for the interior. So on the interior of this face, of course it's not interior in the whole space, these are the unbroken things, the one broken things. So you can actually use the functor F00, which we introduced in the first lecture, to go from here to here, to cut this thing, which has one interface precisely at the interface. Yeah? So you look at building of high 2, yeah? If you are in S theta 0. This is degeneracy 1. This means each thing has height 2, so top floor is 1, number is 1. And you can only chop it at one point in the middle. So, and the chopping was the F00, so you get this. And then the theorem is, so you study the topology and so on. This map is continuous on orbit space. So if you pass to orbit space, this is continuous. And it has a continuous extension to the closure.
Chief,
yeah?
Can you maybe, in the big picture of I want to define, say, Fleur theory and maybe prove D squared equal to 0, tell me what we're about to try and do here?
Well, as the Fleur, whatever theory, comes from the interplay of which I explained, and I think I precisely explained in the first lecture, the covering functors associated between the boundary of S and the fibered product. So I'm using now them and show that they actually line up continuously by doing this, creating this kind of thing. So it's a continuation of this discussion by putting now the topology in the game.
So why would I care if all I want to do is define Fleur theory?
Well, if there wouldn't be no continuity, you wouldn't define anything.
So what is the continuity? Where does that come in?
Well, wait for a little while.
Yeah, so how if I would be on a manifold and it would just consist out of points, I would not be talking about curvature. So I have to have a notion of topology and smoothness to be able to talk about it. So I'm explaining to you now that these covering functors actually are continuous. F0 is continuous on orbit space and has a continuous extension, I think. That says that you can extend,
something to do with d² equal to 0.
Yeah, I thought that is why we are here. I thought that was implicitly understood.
But how exactly?
I'm in lecture number 2.
But what are you trying to...
Okay, but I explained to you precisely that among these conditions, algebraically, d theta equals f star theta p. That is where the stuff comes from.
So that's what you want to achieve with this?
No, this we already know algebraically, but I have to perturb this functor, so I need more structure to be able to do so. So now I'm studying these relationships and show that certain things are continuous, even smooth.
So that you'll be able to perturb it. So.
Yes. Okay. So this has a continuous extension. And the image of a connected of any theta is a connected component in that space, in this fibered product, in the orbit space of this fibered product. So also every connected component comes from a phase. So you see already topological data, connected components in this fibered product correspond to phases and so on. And here is an explanation for how this extension here, the continuous extension of this, comes by putting several of the previously algebraic defined things together. Yeah? So if I'm on the interior of a phase, the only functor of the structure which I have before, which I can apply is F0, 0, then I go to the closure of this one broken things, and there might be many things which are very often broken. Yeah.
Is this theorem kind of obvious, or is this...
No, it's not that difficult, but you have to write down what the topology is and look at the pictures, and you see this.
So somehow this is just, if I think about Fleur theory, this is about viewing boundary of trajectory spaces as sequences of broken things.
Well, if you just would look at one-dimensional components, or zero, then it's all trivial. But since I'm discussing also higher-dimensional modular spaces.
This is the game where I have like a three times broken thing I can view.
Yeah. So if the three times broken thing lies in the closure of a specific phase, so these are of one times broken thing which broke over certain things, then I have a continuous extension of that functor on orbit space over this. And the extension depends from which phase I come. That is where the algebra comes from. So if I extend that phase, there's a particular extension, and if I do this. So if you look at S theta, so on S theta 0, it's just a functor F0, 0. But on the boundary, it actually looks like this. These are the guys, the algebraic guys which we saw. So this continuous extension can be represented as a functor and pieced together from the Fijs which I had. Yeah. So the Fijs were only defined on certain strata, namely on things which were I plus J plus 1 times, had this height.
Can you remind us what Fij was?
Yeah, so Fij was... This was just forgetting. Just forgetting at the right spot the asymptotic markers.
Where is something non-trivial happening in this theorem? I mean, you're taking things that you knew were continuous. You're putting them together by algebraic operations, and then you're forgetting a finite amount of data.
So the first time, I just was talking about the algebra of things. Now. Here, this was in some sense like Fij was defined on a completely different strata of the category than something else, yeah? So algebraic strata. So now what this says is actually you can piece them continuously together. That is what this says. And the interesting thing is that this functor now, which goes from the category of phases to this fiber product with two factors over the component associated, so the image of theta is a connected component, is, so this functor here is an SC smooth covering functor. So since I have a smooth structure now, I have a smooth structure for the fiber product, and I can look at, then it turns out that this induces a smooth structure on this as well. And then this thing is actually a smooth functor. And you can imagine how a smooth functor, it's almost like this continuity. So it means you can, if I have an object here and an object here which projects on it, I can take two things so that that functor actually maps this slice into this slice and the local representation is smooth.
Helmut, I think we have a wonderful candidate for your explanation this evening. You can give us an example of this, where you have a very simple example, flow trajectories with, say, three breakings or something, and show us what the content of the curve is.
Okay.
It's actually very, it's very obscure to me, I have to say.
Okay, so...
I mean, I believe the content, I trust you to that extent, but where it's hidden,
It just says that this family of functors defined on different stratas just line up to something continuous on the thing and something smooth. Okay, good.
Yeah, anyway,
okay, here is a picture to explain that to you.
Nearly the
okay.
End of this
yes. Okay. So consider here this object. Yeah, so it has periodic. This stands for periodic orbits here and here, and it breaks twice. Okay, so if I look at this kind of thing here, which would not break here, that would be in a phase. And if I would look at this thing here, and it would break here, it would be another phase. And this red stuff lies in the closure, it lies in the intersection of these two phases. Yeah. So if you take the closure of things like this, this clearly lies in there. And if you take the closure of this, that lies in there as well. So it lies here. So now you see already that three different connected components in orbit space come into play. This one, that one, and that one. So you have A, B, and C. Now, you also have this one comes into play, which is Q, a connected component Q, and this one comes into play, which is a connected component P. And all this stuff might be in a connected component E.
Is Q equal to sigma 1?
No, sigma... One of the sigmas is a phase in this. So these are all connected components. Yeah? E, Q, P, C, B, and A. So now if you look now at the category theta 1 intersect with theta 2, that's the category associated to the intersection of the phases, then and you take this functor F theta 1, then it would, so what would it do? It would just go... It would preserve this here, and it would chop up this one. So you go into SA, then you get this thing here, but this thing here is actually a phase in S... This is a phase in SQ. So if this is Q here, then this one would lie in Q, but it would be broken once, so it would be a phase in SQ. Yeah? So... If I look at, so this object lies here in the intersection.
What is sigma 2? Equal to Q, right?
No, it's a phase of sigma.
Phase.
It's a phase.
So sigma 2, this thing here, this thing here lies in a phase of sigma Q, called S sigma 2.
What is the difference between sigma 2 and Q?
It's a phase. Sigma 2 is a phase in Q.
And Q is a point in that phase.
But there, A is a point.
No. This, so what I describe here, so the connected component like this is C. The connected component containing this is called B, and the connected A. The connected component calling this is Q. The connected component containing this one is E, and so on. So now, if I have an object in here, this type of broken things. So now, F theta 1, that is the lowest one, would forget data here.
I'm equally confused as Captain. What does sigma 2 mean?
So sigma...
Sigma 2 is a phase. Is a phase in Q.
Of SQ. So it consists of things which go... things which lie in C and B, but have gluing data at B. That's what it consists of. And the things which are in theta 1 intersect theta 2 are twice broken, so they have things in ABC, and you keep all the gluing data. And what he's talking about is F theta 1 is he forgets the gluing data.
So here you would take such an object, forget the gluing data here. Then you get this thing here, which lies in the connected component A, and you get this broken thing here lying in the connected component Q. But since it's broken, it has to be lying in a face. So now if I do the same here, forget this here, that would be going down here. I would get this thing here lying in a face sigma 1 of P, and I would get something in the connected component C. Then, of course, I can chop again, the things. And then I'm ending up in the triple fiber product. And that's commutative. And these are all smooth covering functions.
They're all smooth, and it's commutative and they're smooth covering
functions. And they're smooth covering functions. That's the important thing. So these are actually, for the smooth structure, they are smooth objects, they're covering functors. And then when you pull back data, it will be smooth and so on. That is how the whole stuff starts.
So ultimately, the geometric input there is smoothness of the Kriegluing map? What is the...
So of course, I mean, algebraically, it's sort of obvious already.
Yeah,
it's sort of something covering, but that is actually compatible with the gluing and so on, and nicely compatible with our notion of smoothness. And then, actually, I'm done. You see? Okay, so that was actually pretty good. So, in my estimate. So,
look, why don't we start? I think we've had enough of that. Why don't you start this evening with this slide?
There's something like sublime would happen if I just say this. It's just a summary. So what we want to see is our deformations, we want to have smooth functors in the sense how I explained it. They should satisfy this identity, and this identity here is the algebraic identity reorganized. But now all the ingredients you see here are smooth functors. And again, that is what we already found in the first lecture, is we want to find such things which are smooth, satisfying this identity, and having all these properties. And these things will be constructed as a solution of a Fredholm problem.
Thank you.